Thank you. to me, whatever it is that your friends may be going through, your family may be going through, please serve with all the greatest blessings. She just decreed and declared over your life that God's blessings are going to be upon you and the next generation and the next generation. And so if you receive it, if you receive it, lift your hands this evening in holy praise. Accept what God has given you this evening. And be hands to be up right now receiving the blessings of our God and our Savior. Tonight we're going to talk about worship, and I'm not going to take up too much of your time. We're going to talk about some tough stuff. And so, Father, I just invite your presence into this room. The atmosphere has been shifted. Our dream is set so beautifully. And so, God, I invite you with prayer. We invite you with praise, and Lord, let this little talk provide a help. Speak safe from under your ears, that may your people be changed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. I promise I won't take up too much of your time. And I have some musicians in the house. If y'all get up and walk up and be offended, so y'all better stay right where you are. So tonight we're going to be talking about worship. We're not going to take too long, if you would. Turn in your Bibles for me if you got your Bibles in your hand. Turn with me to the book of Joshua. The book of Joshua, verses chapter 6. Joshua chapter 6. It's a very interesting story that is told in the book of Joshua, chapter 6. The Bible says, now the gates of Jericho were securely barred because of the Israelites. No one went out and no one came in. And the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have delivered the Jericho into your hands, along with its king and its fighting men. March around the city once with all the armed men. Do this for 6 days. Have 7 days carry trumpets and ram's horns and in front of the ark on the seventh day. On the seventh day, march around the city 7 times with a piece of blow trumpet. And when you hear them sound the long blast of trumpets, have the whole army give a loud shout, and the wall of the city will collapse, and the army will go up, everyone straight in. So Joshua, son of Nun, called the priest, he said to them, take up the ark of the covenant of the Lord, and have 7 priests carry trumpets in front of it. And he ordered the army advance to march around the city, with an armed guard going ahead of the ark of the Lord. So we're going to skip down to verse 15. On verse 15, the Bible says, on the seventh day, they got up at daybreak and marched around the city 7 times in the same manner, except that on that day, they circled the city 7 times, the 7th time around. When the priest sounded the trumpet blast, Joshua commanded the army, shout, for the Lord has given you the city, and all that is in it are to be devoted to the Lord. Only Rahab the prostitute, and all who are with her in her house, shall be spared, because she hid the spies, we say. And so tonight, this little sermon is just what we call worship. The Bible tells us that Joshua and Jesus were having this conversation, and Jesus gave Joshua some directions. And so what we're going to talk about is today we're going to talk about how we worship, why we don't know how to worship, and what gets in the way of worship. You see, we as Christians today, it is my assessment that we don't know how to worship. See, we think coming to church, singing a couple of songs, listening to a sermon, and greeting your fellow believers once a week is worship. And so many people have gotten so used to going to church on a Sunday or going to church on a Saturday, and that is it. Worship, ladies and gentlemen, is an outer expression of your inner gratitude. In other words, your worship can only be as good as the inner dwelling of the Holy Spirit. You see, when I pray that prayer tonight, I ask the Holy Spirit to come into the room right now, because we keep calling on God's name. We keep praying in Jesus' name when nobody ever wants it. I ask the Holy Spirit to dwell inside of them. But my Bible tells me in the New Testament that when Jesus ascended up on high, he said that one great is going to come after me, that the Holy Spirit will descend down and he will be a comforter. And so your worship becomes an inner expression of your gratitude to God. See, what keeps happening is everybody keeps showing up to church for a paying service, and then we get upset when the check is short. The singing is good, the preaching is good, your presence in church is good, but if there's nothing on the inside, there's no manifestation on the outside. You wonder why the amens are so dry, the emotions are so weak, the praise is so tepid, there is no experience to express your inner feelings. Oh, but I'm a little bit shy, so I don't express myself like this. I'm not going to make a spectacle of myself. The church cannot put a church cannot dictate what your worship looks like, because the church doesn't know what you have been through. The church doesn't know that when you read your scriptures this week, some strongholds were broken. The church doesn't know that when you sang this week, you got chills in your car. And when you prayed this week, some bills got paid, some sins were broken forever, some relationships got affected this week, and some of your friends or your so-called friends got affected because of your faith and your change. A change that stirred up, and now that you've come to church, nobody can tell you to bottle up your worship. We've become corporate worshipers when we should be disruptive worshipers. God doesn't fit in our 9-to-1 services, and neither should your worship. Too many spectator Christians waiting for the moment to be just right, so they don't look out of place. But there's three things that worship will do for you. See, but I didn't realize, right? I'm going to come back to Jericho a little bit. But if you go back to Joshua 2, there was a prostitute named Rahab, and Rahab had been despised. And interesting, as a matter of fact, I've been told in phrase that I can read the scripture on the top of the army, but I haven't been a little bit. I'll bring my phone to me and kind of highlight there for a minute. How the Bible says, thank you, Lord, I appreciate it. So, working on the Asian technology right now, see God, I'm working on several different things. So, the Bible says in verse 10, no wonder a hard time back to in fear. Rahab says, no one has the courage to fight after hearing such things. For the Lord your God is the supreme God of the heavens above and the earth below. Now swear to me, she says, by the Lord that you will be coming to me and my family. Since I have helped you, give me some guarantee. And when Jericho is conquered, you will let me live along with my father, my mother, my brothers and sisters, and all of your families and the rest of them. Generation upon generation, we offer our own lives as a guarantee for your safety. If you don't betray us, we will keep our promise and be kind to you when the Lord gives us land. There's a couple of things that worship will do. The first thing that Rahab did is that she professed the name of the Lord. And some of us are having a hard time professing the name of the Lord because of what we're doing the other 6 days of the week. The next thing that Rahab did was she asked for guarantees, and your worship will give you some guarantees. And the last thing that she did is that God will hold his promises. She asked those men to give her a promise, and they held to that promise. Not only is Rahab a good example of this, but if you look at our Bibles, if you put up on the screen for y'all, also 2 Samuel 6, verse 14. This is a beautiful scripture. But if you come down to verse 14, the Bible says, when talking about worship, because the church can't put a copy of worship, David says, and David danced before the Lord with all his might. And David was girded with a little ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord, which shall end with the sound of the trumpet. And as the ark of the Lord came into the city, David, Michael, Saul's daughter, looked through a window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. And they brought in the ark of the Lord and set it in his place in the midst of the tabernacle that David had pitched for it. And David offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord. And as soon as David had made an end of the offering, burnt offerings and peace offerings, he blessed the people that included folks. And he dealt among the people, all people, even among the whole multitude of Israel, as well as the women, as well as to everyone a cake of bread and a good piece of flesh. Coming down to the end, verse 21 says, and David said unto Michael, it was before the Lord which chose me before thy father, and before all his house to appoint me ruler over the people of the Lord, over Israel, and therefore will I plead before the Lord, and I will yet be more vessel than thus, and will be base in my own sight, out of the many servants which thou hast spoken of, and of them shall I be high in honor. See, some of y'all don't understand that King James Rose and stuff. Break it down for you one more time, so that I'm going to read from the Message version. I'm going to go back down to verse 14. You see, Michael was Saul's daughter, and Saul's daughter looked out her window, and she saw David praising, but she didn't understand what David was praising about. You see, if you go back in the scripture, the Ark of the Covenant is where God dwelled, and so God was literally coming into the city. And so when David saw the Ark of the Covenant, he was excited about God coming into the city. It was like David was going to meet God, and so David started to dance. He started to dance out of his clothes so much so that his nakedness was shown. But David did people will despise you for your worship. People will have something to say about your worship. But when there is no cap on your worship, David was celebrating the arrival of the ark. And when you're celebrating what God has done in your life, people cannot put a cap on that. Romans 12, verse 1 says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. David was cleaning himself up to meet his God. Let me flip this for you guys. If you look at the word worship, see, the English language messes up the Hebrew translation. But if you look at the word worship in Hebrew, the translation is Avodah in Hebrew. But the word Avodah is used biblically and in Hebrew to also mean work and service. You see, when Jesus told the Israelites to march around Jericho, they had to put in work, and they had to put in a little bit of service. They only got the reward on the seventh day when they let out the shout. You see, we struggle with worship because we don't put in the work and we don't put in the service. That there is no greater. Let me say it another way. We struggle with worship because we don't put in the work, but we expect to come and have service. There is no greater manifestation of worship than through service. Through service, you see the pain of your brother. Through service, you see the struggle of your brother and the experience of your fellow man. With it comes thanksgiving of a loving God. That's not dealt with you the way you deserve it. Because I can tell you right now, I'm not sure what your life is like, but I know in my heart of hearts, I should have been dead and gone a long time ago. There's many an opportunity God could have snuffed me out. There's many an opportunity that God could have snuffed my wife out. There's many an opportunity God could have snuffed my children out. But somehow, God left the 99 and came to find me. He thought that I was worth something. And so he looked through the annals of time and he saw St. J. Brown was going to mess up. And he sent his only begotten son to die on a cross for me. I wish I could kneel down beside my baby now and pray. And God will keep me in his bosom. There is no greater austerity than the work of worship. There is no worship without conflict, though. And there is no growth without pressure. Some of us are trying to work, we can't get. See, we're not just having the worst experience because we don't have no conflict. We're in conflict, but we're focusing on the wrong things. So God ain't going to take you through nothing. And you got to check yourself because if you ain't a big through nothing, you got to read it. You got to check yourself now. Are you on the devil's side or are you on the Lord's side? See, we don't know what worship is. Worship, when you've lost everything and God has restored it, you don't pray the same way. When you've lost something, lost a loved one, you've been through something, you just don't, you don't come all with it and you just have a dry in your hand. The hand may shoot up. You may dance a little bit, it's okay. It's okay. Because nobody can put a cap on your worship. Colossians 3:14 says, he says, and above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony, and let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful that the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, with thankfulness in your hearts to God, and whatever you do, in word or deed, every day in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father, through him worship, worship. Worship is love expressed through your affirmations. Worship is love expressed through your prostrations, lifting up your hands, and professions of your feelings. If worship is love and love is intimacy, then worship would be like whispering sweet nothings into your loves and your holding hands and doing all the things you don't talk about in church. But something I'm going to do anyway. Love is worship and worship is love. The difference is in the elevation we give to the things we love on earth and the integration we give to love which of God. See, we focus on loving the objects instead of loving the object of our affection. If you can't imagine going a day without saying, I love you to your boo, then why should God get less? If you can't go a day without texting or calling your boo, then why should God get any less? If you feel like you can't breathe without a little bit of intimacy, then why should God get any less? We see God like he's another woman. We pick him up when we want to. We get a little bit of satisfaction every Saturday. We put him back down. He goes back to living under the way he's doing. That's the next 6 days of the week. Maybe some of y'all treat God like a Tinder date. You want to hook up with to 2 Corinthians. Oh, no, 1 Corinthians 13. See, this is the best service, but I want you to think about this for a minute. If worship is love and love is worship, and God's love is in us, that means we are love, and if God is love, and we're the manifestations of God, then we are also love. So when we read 1 Corinthians 13, verse 4, it says, love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it is not arrogant, desire, avarice, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angry, it is not reckless, wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Now we flip on his head because God is love, and worship is love, and if God is innocent that we are love, then we can also then say, this is the hunt, is patient, this is the hunt, is kind. This is the hunt, does not envy, this is the hunt, does not boast, this is the hunt, does not pride. She does not dishonor others, she is not self-seeking, she is not easily angered, she does not keep record for others. She does not deny evil, but rejoice in the church, with the truth rather. She always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always prospers. I'm going to bring it home to myself, saying, she is patient, saying, she is kind. He does not envy, he does not boast, he does not proud, he does not dishonor others, he does not self-seeking, he does not self-seeking, he does not get easily angered, he keeps on record for others. He does not deny evil, but rejoice in the truth. This is hard for us to hear because we're so evil with ourselves sometimes. He always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. But if we are the bodies that make up the church, then the church should be love, and we should be manifesting worship at church. That means our church and our worship should be love, so that we can say, my Zion is patient, my Zion is kind, my Zion does not envy, my Zion does not boast, my Zion is not proud, my Zion does not dishonor, it does not self-seeking, it is not easy anger. It keeps on record strong. My Zion does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. My Zion always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. That is what your worship experience can do for you, because love is the foundation of why Jesus came here to be with us. And if we're not manifesting that, then we've got to check ourselves and go back to the drawing board and pray that we can get to that higher plane. See, we let everything get in the way of our worship. And so I'm saying, especially on everything we do, we get God what's living oftentimes, our worship be worth. Matthew 1:6-14 says, a son honors his father and a servant his master. If they are the father, where is my honor? If I'm a master, where is my reverence? Says the Lord of hosts. To you, please, who despise my name, and you say, in what way have we despised your name? You offer the final food on my altar. But say, what way have we defiled you? By saying, the table of the Lord is contemptible. And when you offer the blind as sacrifice, is it not evil? And when you offer the lame and sick, is it not evil? Offer it then to your governor. Would he be pleased with you? Would he accept you favorably? Says the Lord of hosts. But now intercede God's favor, that he may be gracious to us. While this is being done by your hands, will he accept you favorably? Says the Lord of hosts. Who is there even among you who would shut the doors so that you would not kindle fire my altar with vain? I'll have no pleasure in you, says the Lord of hosts, nor will I accept an offering from your hands. For from the rising of the sun, even to its going down, my name shall be great among the Gentiles. In every place, incense shall be offered to my name, and a pure offering for my name shall be great among the nations. In other words, I'm not going to read the rest of it. God will need what you're giving him. If your worship isn't genuine, it's not worth anything. So it is a bitter smell to God when you come in living in a dirty way, then come into church and try to praise anyway. That praise ain't going up. So you come in with a pure heart, so when you kick that door, you ask God to wash you of everything, but not so that you can go back into it, Pastor. Pastor Williams talked about this. We know the temptation is going to come. I'm tempted like anybody else, but it's a practice of sin. Now, y'all ain't going to put no time on it. Y'all took an hour. I'm going to take my time. Don't be waiting for 5 minutes to tell you. Y'all took your time. The practice of sin is the issue. The practice of sin. And so, y'all talking about that yesterday, and saying, what has helped me to overcome my old age that I've stayed on my knees my entire life? And there are some strongholds that were broken in my 60s that I couldn't break in my 50s. And now that I'm going to 70, I feel refreshed. In fact, he said his blood pressure had come down as a result of strongholds that have been broken. He stayed on his knees for decades sometimes. It's going to take a while, but you keep on fighting the good fight, you keep on buying it with God. It's all right, but then y'all can start playing out the solution to all worship. Worship makes the joy part of why it is your innermost being. Psalms 95, 6 says, oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into the presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to Him with songs of praise. For the Lord is great God, a great King above all gods. In His hand are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are His also. The sea is His. For He made it, and His hands formed the dry land. Worship, ladies and gentlemen, can be practiced through discipline. You see, I asked Melinda even to give me a word that was going to set everything up, and I actually said discipline. I was going to find a way to get discipline there, but worship can be practiced through discipline. Colossians 3:16 says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing songs and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. Sometimes it takes me in the 5 o'clock in the morning to read that scripture, and you don't need to read the whole thing at one time. You don't have to do the Bible in a year. You start one chapter at a time and let that nourish your soul. Job said, see, Job is the oldest book of the Bible. The Genesis Chronicles is the beginning of the Bible, but Job is the oldest book of the Bible. After Job had been through it all, the Bible says in verse 21, then Job arose and tore his robe and shaved his head and fell on the ground and worshipped. And he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away a blessing. In the name of the God, Job had his priorities in order. He understood that he was going to worship, and he saw God had taken everything. And so even when you're going through worship and praise anywhere, anyhow, because through worship comes your praise. Worship and praise are not necessarily the same thing, but through your worship comes your praise, it comes your adoration, it comes your songs, it comes the manifestations. Worship originates from the word worth. Says, worthy are you, O Lord, and God, to receive glory, honor, and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. The root word is worthy. It is unworthy of being created with Avoda, what I talked about a little earlier. Worship is Old English for worship, which means acknowledgement of worth or merit. If your worship is equated with the worthiness of my God, if your worship isn't manifested out of the true innermost thanksgiving of your heart, then your worship is not worth it. Let me unravel some of your programming for you. There are four types of worship. There's a liturgical worship, non-liturgical, informal, and private. Private worship. The liturgical is the structured worship. If anybody went into a Catholic or Presbyterian church, you understand what a liturgical worship is. And then the non-liturgical is something like what we are now practicing. You see, at Seventh-day Adventist, we used to have a certain order, but my desire is becoming disruptive in this worship. And then we also have informal types of worship, and this could be held anyway. Think Kanye West out on the hill somewhere trying to have worship. I'm not sure if it is, but that's what he's trying to do. I'm not sure what God he's praying to, but we let the brother do what he do. And then we got private worship. That's your innermost worship. What do you think? You better be doing your thing with God and having a connection. You see, Western culture tamed your expression when Judeo-Christian was taught to early slaves, and we succumbed to the liturgical structure that continues to inhabit many of the dominant religions to this day. You see, there's a reason why, don't sit here and lie, there's a reason why y'all be saying there's a white church and a black church. The experience is a very, very different thing. We never knew props for hundreds of years. Something that was what was given on to us. And I'm not arguing in favor of the many gods of our ancestors. There is but one God, one foundation, only one through which we can receive salvation. We were not hardwired, however, as people to be controlled. Jesus showed us that example. He was not bound by the Pharisees or the teachings of the day. Jesus came to disrupt the order of religion, to let everybody know that you don't have to follow these rules or to be constrained anymore. You can receive life through me and through the Father, but no one gets to the Father but through me. So as we bring this thing to a close, the greatest benefit that we can have through our worship is that we can move mountains. And you have to get rid of some of the thinking. We can move mountains. I've seen mountains move in my life. It may not have been a physical mountain, but unfortunately, we keep trying to push hills. But we can move mountains. And so we have to believe that God can move those mountains in our life. The next benefit is our mind.
service.